Good morning and welcome to all you busy talkers out there. This is your goose. Goose to your pew, please. Welcome to St. Thomas Lutheran Church this morning on this wonderful, light, airy, cool summer morning. Carl is my father-in-law. He's waving his hand. I was just talking with him yesterday, and he was like, "It's so cool here." Well, he's from St. Louis. And so he understands hot, heat, and humidity. And so we're just going to enjoy the nice, cool lake air, aren't we? So. Of course, Carl and Sheila, my in-laws, are here this weekend to help us with our unpacking of our truck, which went so well yesterday. A good team came together. We got our final moving truck unpacked very quickly. And so a big thank you to everyone who helped with that project yesterday. A couple of notes before we get started today. One, before I forget it, I don't know, you were all chatting so much, which is wonderful, but Matt here was doing a wonderful introductory organ piece that was really playing with the melody of 932, which we're going to be singing today. And it was just amazing. And I was praying at the altar, or trying to, but my heart kept on getting swept up in the melody. So Matt, thank you for that. And thank you for the gifts that you have that you share with us each and every week. So for worship here, remember to sign in on the in the pew card or in the on in the books or so you make sure we get a good tally of you. We don't want to forget doing that. If you're a guest, give us a little bit of information. We have bags for children on the welcome table out there so that kids can occupy themselves with fidgets and a children's bulletin and such things. That's new. We thank Becky Benson for pulling those together for us this past week. In last week's weekly email, there wasn't a weekly email this week because, and I want to thank another Matt Pesty, for telling me, don't feel like you have to do one of those every week during the summer. And as I was unloading my moving truck, I was like, thank you, because I'm a little occupied. So not every week we'll have a weekly email. Probably most we will. But I mentioned that I need hosts for dinner parties. I have three hosts so far. I just need a couple more. So if it is your gift to put on a wonderful hosting spread for guests, let me know, we'll talk, and then I'll get all the hosts together and we'll go over my secret plan. So that'll be fun. Today's worship folder is based on the service of prayer and preaching, which is a liturgy in our hymnals. We don't use prayer and preaching often or haven't, but it's something I want to incorporate because prayer and preaching has a good chief purpose, and that is bringing us back into the catechism and the teachings of our faith. And so for non-communion Sundays, we'll incorporate a little bit of prayer and preaching, and we'll highlight a piece of the catechism, and we'll work through Luther's prayer this summer as our special piece of the catechism. And so that's why that's in the service bulletin, if you were wondering about that. Let's see, is there anything else I have to say? Any other announcements that we need to let everybody know about? Ira's coming through the door. Okay, so the voters meeting is at the end of the month, which is the 28th? The 23rd. 23rd voters meeting. Date change. It was in the weekly email, wasn't in the bulletin last week. Voters meeting, 23rd. Let's remember it. You'll get to hear me stumble through my first voters meeting at St. Thomas. It'll be a gift for everyone. Okay, I think that's all the notes we have. So let's share the peace of the Lord. Thank you.
yesterday. Can you read?
Okay, as you make your way back to your place of sitting, please stay standing for our opening hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. This is the day which the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
From the rising of the sun to its setting.
In the name of the Lord, receive grace.
Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. Make me to know your ways, O Lord.
Teach me your paths.
Sanctify us in your truth.
Your word is truth.
From the rising of the sun to its setting. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Seated for our Old Testament lesson.
The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday after Pentecost is from Genesis chapter 3. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden, in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman who you gave to me to be with me, she gave me fruit of the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock, above all the beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and 5. Since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what has been written, I believed, and so I spoke. We also believe, and so we also speak, knowing that he who has raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence. For it is all for your sake, so that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart. Though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. For we know that if the tent, which is our earthly home, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. This is the word of the Lord.
Please rise for the Holy Gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the third chapter. Then Jesus went home, and the crowd gathered again, so that they could not even eat. And when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, "He is out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, "He is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of demons he cast out demons." And he called to him and said to them in parables, "How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed he may plunder his house. Truly I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter, but whoever blasphemies against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, he has an unclean spirit. And his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside they sent to him and called to him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. And he answered them, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking about at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. This is the gospel of the Lord. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. The portion of the catechism that we are being refreshed on this morning is the introduction of the Lord's Prayer. The introduction, Our Father who art in heaven. What does this mean? With these words, God tenderly invites us to believe that he is our true Father and that we are his true children, so that with all boldness and confidence, we may ask him as dear children ask their dear Father. Congregation may be seated. Children may come forward for a children's message. Who are you?
So do you know what it means? Do you pray the Lord's Prayer? you guys pray the Lord's Prayer.
So who are you talking to?
The Lord.
That is the Lord.
So when you say the Lord, does that mean is he kind of scary because he's in charge of everything? Why is he not scary? Because he's a good guy? Do we call him Lord in the Lord's Prayer? Well, what do we say? We say our
Father.
We call him Father. That's right. And so, are you scared of your Father? You're sure? Well, Jesus was just having a really hard conversation about his family. And you might not have heard that. It's a very confusing story. Because in that story, Jesus says that the people around him who are following God's word, that are trusting in him, are his family. And so what does it mean to be a part of a family?
You get born from them.
You get what?
Born from them.
You get what from them?
Born.
You get born from them. Well, that's true. Definitely with Jesus in a spiritual and physical sense. But he's saying his family members aren't his family, but the family members who believe in him are his family. Is that confusing? Yes, it is confusing. It is confusing. But it means that with Jesus, the
people that come together
and trust in Jesus and follow Jesus are family. And so, is Mr. Don over there a member of your family?
Mm-hmm.
Is he a member of your family?
Yes.
Yes. You might not know him very well, but you know what I told Mr. Don when I first met him?
What?
That he looks almost exactly like my grandpa.
Yeah.
Yeah, see it? You see it? No, but Mr. Don's a member of your family. And there's Miss Sandy over there. She's a member of your family. And we have Miss Terry over there. She's a member of your family. Oh, and who's behind Miss Terry? Who is that back there? Is that Grandma?
She.
It's Grandma She. Is she a member of your family?
Yes.
Yes, she's a member of your family. Jesus is saying that he's the one that makes us all a member of the same family. And every family has a father. So who's our father?
Jesus.
No, he's a son. Who's our father?
God.
Yeah, God's our father. And so Jesus, in giving us the Lord's Prayer, is pulling our whole family together under our Father. So does that make us think about family differently?
Yeah.
Yeah. You guys are good sports. I know you're having a hard time. Why don't we go ahead and close this up? But instead of doing one of our repeat prayers, why don't we pray the Lord's Prayer together? And so, Leah, can you read this line for us?
By our Lord and trusting his promise, we are bold to pray.
Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Seats.
And the plan goes back to your seats. We sing
hymn 761, Rock of Ages.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So, I want to ask you a question. When you first meet someone, how do you size them up? What is the algebra that's going through your head when you see somebody for the first time and you're trying to gauge who they are, how you should respond to them, what kind of interaction should be happening? And the truth is, we like to use all the information we have available to us at that moment to try to figure out what to do. And that can be helpful. A lot of times it can get us in trouble. Because the only information we have when we're meeting someone for the first time is what they look like, is their appearance. So when you look at someone, what is it that you assume about that person? And how do the appearances of all of us frame our assumptions or expectations from each other? When you're coming across someone and they are generally younger than you, what kind of expectations do you have for them? You probably are not expecting them to regale you with wisdom from a pulpit, maybe. You probably have a specific playbook that you think younger people are occupied with. They're all consumed in that social media and technology, and they don't do the things the way that we used to do when we did them when I was younger. And so they're obviously destroying the economy by killing all these businesses that we used to rely on. Ever seen the millennials killed X industry type of articles? Let's see, I don't remember the last one I saw. I know one of them was like, even Dove soap is being destroyed by millennials, apparently. I don't know. But there's assumptions based on how old you think the person is. And the same works the other way, right? So when a younger person comes in contact with an older person, there's generally the assumption that this person doesn't know how to use technology, and they're going to ask me to help them with the technology because they don't know what they're doing. Or the assumption could be that physically I can't expect much help from someone who is older. Or I am trusting that they're not going to understand things the way I see them. And these assumptions build up and they can actually cause problems. Quite a few problems, because we start seeing people for the assumptions we have about them rather than what's actually going on the inside. Another dynamic is how formal or how casual the person is. If someone's walking around in jeans and a t-shirt, you probably don't think they take themselves too seriously. Or maybe even jeans is formal these days. Probably is. Or if you see someone in a full suit, you probably assume that they are taking responsibility for themselves. They're cleaning up after themselves. But both of those assumptions can betray what's going on in the heart. The person running around in a t-shirt might have everything in life together, and the person wearing a suit might be crumbling on the inside. It's all a matter of perspective and assumption. And the last one I want to mention is the telltale markers of socioeconomic excellence or wealth. You probably assume something about a person based on the car they drive, based on how expensive the watch looks, or how elaborate the jewelry. Oh, they must have means. They must have influence. And the people who are more humbly garbed, you don't have those same assumptions. But of course, those can betray the reality. Perhaps the person who is humble in dress is doing it intentionally to not gain attention. Perhaps the person who is showing their wealth is showing, well, everything they could qualify for a loan, and are actually drowning in their own form of poverty. The point is that we get in trouble when we assume things about people on the basis of appearance. And that affects our first time we meet them, but it can continue to affect how we see them even as we go through in a relationship, and it can blind us to seeing people authentically. And that is one aspect of that contributes to the entire discourse between Paul and the Corinthian church. And let me explain how and why. There's a lot going on in our text in 2 Corinthians. To get a bigger picture of it, we're going to have to take a broader look at the entire conversation Paul has with the Corinthian church. And it starts with the history, the planting, which we actually get in Acts, that Paul is the church planter of the Corinthian church. He is the father that birthed their church, or mother. He actually uses that analogy once, that he gave the seeds of faith that allowed them to grow and become a community of Christians. And so time goes by because he has other places to be, other churches to plant, and there become problems at the Corinthian church. A lot of problems, actually. One way you can read the entire letter of 1 Corinthians is that it's a laundry list of all the things the Corinthian church is not doing very well. But it's all framed inside this core spiritual issue that Paul accuses and brings to bear in 1 Corinthians 1. He tells them that they are being swayed. They're being swayed by these so-called super apostles into believing earthly trends and following earthly wisdom. You see, the Corinthian church looked at Paul and thought, Paul ain't nobody. He's a tent maker. He's bald. He does not have eloquent words. He's not a very impressive person in a secular human sense. He's a very humble man. He doesn't look very handsome. And so these super apostles come who are handsome and are wise and eloquent, and they're able to speak in philosophy, and then others come along, and then there becomes this breakdown because some follow one, some follow another. Then some people think they're following Peter, some people think they're following Apollos, and there's divisions because everyone's jostling on following the most impressive super apostle, not on the basis of the message of the gospel, but on how their assumed appearance communicates who they are and what they do. So Paul's diagnosing the problem, and it got so bad that Paul visited them after writing 1 Corinthians. We get an allusion of this in 2 Corinthians, and that was a bad visit. It did not go well. It was a tragedy. There was conflict. It was painful. It was extremely painful because they were still fighting and they were still disregarding Paul's authentic claim of apostleship and spiritual leadership. That followed by another letter, which is actually one we don't have access to. It's just referred to. 2 Corinthians is actually 3 Corinthians. As far as we know, it might be 5 Corinthians. But in this other letter is this ask for reconciliation. And then at some point between that letter and 2 Corinthians, there was some form of tangible reconciliation. And then once we get to 2 Corinthians, Paul is just going through them and building them up on the shared understanding of who he is, who they are, how they're called to see and interact with one another. Not on the basis of worldly wisdom or power, but on the basis of the gospel. Not on the outward appearance of a person, but on that which is inside, being transformed, being renewed by the gospel truth, building us up in eternal presence and identity apart from our physical appearance. And Paul expounds on that idea. And he tells us that although the body is wasting away, you are being renewed by internally through the gift and the working of God and his Spirit in you. You are being renewed inside. And by God's grace, that renewal inside begins to shine outward. It's a grace-laden thing to be told that what's happening to your body, what you look like, the circumstances of your flesh don't bear the last word about who you are. But there's something internal that God is causing inside of you called faith, saving faith, a faith that transforms you. It recreates you. It changes your priorities. It enables you to see the world differently. You can have hope when you're looking into death. You can see resurrection when there all that seems is hopelessness. There's some debate around how much Platonic philosophy affects these texts. And I think any allusion of that would be secondary to Paul's purpose of reframing how Christians are meant to perceive one another, not on the basis of appearance, but on the basis of God's word. We should not be seen as representing our temporal reality, but being the eternal people that God has called us to be through our baptisms, through the gospel word, being a people that are set apart for eternity. Although we are wasting away, there's a part of us that will never die. In fact, we will be remade. We will be rebuilt. We will be risen. We will rise again in victory. Jesus Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And so we will be too. And that is who you are. That is who I am. And so when we see each other, that is who we are supposed to see first. A risen child of God with faith and hope. Someone with a renewed understanding of life and death and purpose and priorities. And you don't understand the full weight of this message until you look at someone or you love someone who you can see is wasting away, whose body is falling apart, whose days of mobility are far gone, whose only recourse is to receive medical treatment and life sustenance until God finally calls that individual home. And you might have pity or feel bad to see someone who's physically you would not regard with any sort of glory or honor or praise until you can recognize that although the outside is wasting away, the inside is being renewed by the pouring out of faith and the gift of the gospel, that even out of the most broken and mangled body is a heart of someone who will live forever, the eternity that will last. And how fun is it to look at someone who is falling apart and to tell them, you are being renewed. What's going on right now is not the final destination. The tent is falling away, a skyscraper is going to be built in its place. You are being renewed inside and out. Your reality transcends any sort of shortcoming or any sort of weakness perceived physically. And if you are a hotshot who has charisma, I don't know anything about that. You're to be remember that we are all given this shining light. We are all sinners. We're all broken pots. We're all being remade, renewed, and given eternal life. That is Christ's gift for you. Amen. May the peace that transforms our understanding guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. I invite the ushers to come forward to collect our tithes and offerings. Thank you. your eyes. In addition to the names and our prayers this morning, and Ira, I just want you to tell me if I got this right, because it was a lot of information. Jeanette Staley, is that her name? Is Ira around? Janet Staley. Son recently had a stroke. Son-in-law. And what was the other thing that she's going through? Yeah, her niece was killed, that's right. So we want to not only pray for her, but her entire family, as they mourn and they struggle through these really tough times, that they be reminded about the internal reality beating greater than the one external that is wasting away. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel, the calling of all the faith, let us pray to the Lord. For this nation, for our cities and communities, for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord. For seasonable weather, for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, for all who travel, especially during the summer months, let us pray to the Lord. For those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphaned, for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord. For the sick and dying, for all those who care for them, let them be restored with their understanding of their eternally renewed life that has its end in eternity. Let us pray to the Lord. For Judy, for Keith, for Amber, for Barb, for Marge, for Ginny, for Verna, for Tim, for Janet, and for her whole family. For Becky, let us pray to the Lord. For Becky Sherman, who is attempting to recover from a very bad infection, who is also celebrating this week her 65th wedding anniversary. Be with her in the trial, and also let us thank God for the gift of the commitment in the life of marriage with Dick. Let their wedding continue, their marriage continue to be a testament to your love for us. Let us pray to the Lord. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Almighty and eternal God, your Son, Jesus, triumphed over the prince of demons and freed us from bondage to sin. Help us to stand firm against every assault of Satan and enable us always to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We now sing Jesus Sat with His Disciples. Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We pray the morning prayer. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings in life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve us. Amen.